is just. I'm They didn't have hardwood floors, they had carpet. okay? True story. So in middle school, wearing the knee pads. A lot of y'all don't wear knee pads anymore. Some of y'all still do. Wearing the knee pads, all right? I didn't wear the spandex, all right? I call it spandex, right? I didn't wear that. So I'm kind of like, oh, yeah. Those things were, I was wearing capris, okay? I was wearing capris. But anyway, it was insane because we had a carpet, and if a volleyball came over the net, in middle school, they can't really jump over the net. So I'm like, I can jump, though. Like, I got hot. But if the ball came over the net, someone spiked it, I was supposed to do what? I was supposed to dive, right? Or I was supposed to get it. I was supposed to dig. I was supposed to do something, right? But we were playing on what? Carpet, right? Well, come on now. I'm on a team with 13 girls. And my mom and dad are in the crowd. So do you think I'm going to dive? Of course, right? So I dove and my knees got all skinned up. I mean, I'm putting stuff on, it looks like fingernail polish to put scabs over the cuts that are open. Some are like, that is the most disgusting thing ever. It was pretty disgusting. It was. But I'm diving for this volleyball on carpet. Pretty insane stuff, right? Okay? So I played a sport called basketball also. Okay? And I had this crazy, insane basketball coach. He was insane. Okay, he'd make us, he'd run us to death. I mean, it was during the holidays. He knew we'd just eat a ton of food. And instead of us practicing, we ran the whole time during practice. Okay? But one way that he was just absolutely insane was this is what he would do. All right, this was even hardwood floor. It still would hurt. All right? He would literally have two of us, one on one side of the court, one of us on the other side of the court, and he'd roll the basketball in the middle of the court, and he'd expect one of us to dive and get the basketball. You can hold on to it. He would expect one of us to dive and get the basketball. Like if the ball is on the ground and we're not diving, we're sitting on the bench. All right? So two of us have a potential to collide into each other. This is just absolutely insane. Like I am sacrificing my body in volleyball in middle school. And in basketball, I'm diving on hardwood floor. It's absolutely crazy. Let me see. This is what I want you to think about tonight. You told Timmy. You don't think I can catch my left hand? Come on. But this is what I want you to think. All right? If you think about this. How ridiculous is it that I am sacrificing my body for a basketball? Is that pretty crazy? Think about that. I am sacrificing my body for a basketball or a volleyball. A basketball. Isn't that insane? Y'all think that's crazy? Like, I don't know why people aren't on the sidelines. Like, what are those crazy people doing diving for a ball? Like, that is absolutely insane. See, we sacrifice our body for a lot of things, but one big thing tonight that I believe that we could sacrifice ourselves for is Jesus. We sacrifice ourselves for a lot of things, but what has this basketball done for you? What has a volleyball done for you? Does this do anything for me? Does it talk to me? Some of you are like, this ain't Wilson. This ain't Castaway. All right? But has this basketball done anything for me? Jesus has done everything for us. The only thing that we can contribute to our salvation is our sin. That's it. Jesus has done everything for us. So if Jesus sacrificed himself for us, why wouldn't we sacrifice ourselves for him? I'm talking about Jesus. I'm not talking about basketball. I was insane. I would die for a basketball every play. I would die for a volleyball every play, no matter if it was carpet. How insane is that? It's just a ball. But Jesus has given his life for us. He has sacrificed himself for us. So why in the world when we sacrifice ourselves for him, because he's done a whole lot more than they could ever do, right? Don't even talk. See, what I believe, when we begin to understand how relentless God's pursuit of us was, we will have a radical response to it. When we understand just how relentlessly God has pursued us, how he's so crazy about us that he wants a relationship with us, that he's going to keep knocking on your heart. He's going to keep knocking on your heart till he has your whole complete heart, till he has a relationship with you. And through that, when you get a comprehension of what he has done for you, I believe that there will be a radical response to what he's done for you. I mean, that basketball hadn't done anything for me. Volleyball hasn't done anything for me. But when we're motivated by what God has done for us, his mercy for us, we will give our very lives to him. We will do anything and everything for him, because he's done everything for us. Like, he has gone to the greatest lengths. He has gone to the greatest extreme. Like, if you're like, name the greatest extreme that a person could go to for you, he has done that for you. So why wouldn't we sacrifice ourselves for him? Why wouldn't we? Really believe we'd become a living sacrifice if we truly understood what Jesus has done for us. We would do more than what I do when I play sports. Except now I play football. It's crazy too. Any sport, think about it. You do a lot for it. You sacrifice a lot for it. But what has that sport done for you? But think of all that God has done for you. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to Romans 12 with me. Some of y'all maybe read ahead. I hope you did. Y'all got a little cheat sheet. Last week I told you I was going to read the second half of verse 1. Will y'all stand for me as I read? That don't be Snapchat. You can be on your Bible app. You can tweet points. I don't care. Alright? But I want you guys to pay attention to God's word, give me your attention. Alright? But Romans 12, verse 1, this is what it says. We talked about the first part last week. It says, "Therefore I urge you, I beg you, I encourage you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercies." Alright, we talked about it. It's just not one-time mercy. He has mercy over and over again for us. Alright? In view of all that, in light of all that, this is what Paul encourages us to do, begs us to do. He says, "Offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual / reasonable act of worship." As you're having a seat, tell someone, "Off your body." Some of you are like, "You just made me say something really weird." The first thing that Paul wants us to do, it might sound a little crazy to you, but he says, offer your body. But can I tell you right now, you can't offer your body if you haven't offered him your heart. Some of you are like, "Yeah, you can't." You can, but he knows it's not sincere. You know, our behavior, the way we act, flows from what we believe. Y'all know that? Like, some of y'all are in here tonight, and I don't expect you to act like Jesus because you don't have a heart of Jesus. He's saying offer your bodies, but the first thing that Jesus wants is he wants your heart. After he's had your heart, he's like, "Nah, I don't want you to stop there." Some of you is like, "Nah, like, I've given my life to Jesus." But have you given your body to Jesus? Have you given your body to Jesus? All right? There's two things. He's your Lord and your Savior, all right? Not only does he want your soul, but he wants your body, too, all right? That sounds weird, but I'll unpack it here in a little bit, all right? To say God wants your body, that sounds a little weird, right? Y'all agree with that? Yeah? If y'all put me on YouTube and just cut it off there, "God wants your body," and y'all let me finish that, that'd be a little weird, right? Yeah? So let me go a little further, okay? He wants your body as a living sacrifice. All right? They used to offer up dead sacrifices back in the day. All right? But Jesus has become the ultimate sacrifice for us. He is that lamb that has come to take away the sins of the world. Okay? So he wants to offer our bodies as living sacrifices. Okay? So I'm going to pretend like I'm a sacrifice. All right? So I'm giving God, like, my body. I'm a living sacrifice. All right? The only problem with your body being a living sacrifice is it's not dead. Therefore, a lot of times we like to crawl off the altar. Some of y'all like didn't get that. He's saying offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Well, some of you are like, I'll offer my body as a living sacrifice, but I'm living, so therefore I'm going to crawl off the altar and I'm not going to give him my life 24/7. Like, I'll give it to him on Sunday mornings and I'll give it to him on Wednesday night. And he's like, no, like, give me yourself. Give me yourself. When you present something to somebody, you give it to them in their disposal, right? When I offer you something, like, I give it to you, right? Like, if I offered one of you this mic, like, I'm going to give it to you, right? Like, it's yours. Use it at your disposal, right? God wants you to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. He wants you to say, God, do whatever you want with me. Like, I want my body to be used as a living sacrifice. I want my body to be used for your glory, for your purpose. Is that you? Do you want God to use your body as a living sacrifice to him? Because check this out. Last week we talked about what? In view of his what? In view of his mercy. Isn't it easier to offer your body as a living sacrifice when you think of in view of his mercies for you? Like, he's done a lot for you, right? He's done a lot for you. So why wouldn't we offer our bodies as a living sacrifice? Because check this out. I really believe the greater our comprehension of what Jesus has done for us, the greater our commitment will be. The more we understand what God has done for us, the greater our commitment will be for him. When you guys truly understand that it's not to be taken lightly what Jesus has done for you, I guarantee you there will be a greater commitment in your life. When you're like, holy cow, like, Jesus has done so much for me. He's done ridiculous amount for me. Like, he took the cross from me. He's done so much for me. I love the way someone else puts it. They put it like this. The extent to which we do not offer ourselves to God reflects the extent to which we do not understand the depth and significance of God's mercy. So if some of you are like, hey, I'll give Jesus a little part of me, then you kind of understand what God has done for you a little bit. But I really believe there's going to be a greater extent to which you offer Jesus the more you begin to understand what he's done for you. Do y'all believe that? How many of you believe tonight that God has done a lot for you? Okay. That's good enough. That's good. So our motivation for us offering our bodies as living sacrifices to Jesus is in view of his mercies for you. That's your motivation. You're like, why in the world would I offer my body as a living sacrifice? Like, why would I give myself to Jesus every single day? Because he has had extreme mercies on you. Like, he did not give any of us what we all did deserve. How many have ever gotten in trouble before? You ever gotten in trouble before? A bunch of sinners. I have to. Once or twice. But you ever gotten in trouble before and you had like a punishment? Like, you got grounded for a week or two? Yeah, some of you. But listen, you got to think of Jesus on like a bigger scale. Like, it's not like he just took the punishment for you of you being grounded for a week or two. Like, he took an extreme punishment for you by he took every single one of your sins on the cross for you and he died for you. That's hardcore. He didn't just take time out for you. He didn't take being grounded a week for you. He took the cross for you. Like, that's your main motivation for offering your body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. What more of a motivation do you need than to look at the cross every single day and say, God, what won't I do for you? God, I want to do anything and everything for you because I understand the extent, the sacrifice that you have gone through for me. It's gone through a lot, wouldn't you say? It says, off your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy. Holy. You know what the word holy means right there? It means set apart. It means set apart. See, when we understand God's mercies, we understand what he's done for us, we won't offer our bodies to sin, but we'll offer our bodies to him. Because ask yourself right now. Ask yourself. With what you're doing with your body and how you wake up every single day and how you portray yourself, how you live your life, would God say, man, that's a holy life? That's a holy life. Like, they're set apart. They're set apart. The next question to ask yourself is, would God be pleased? Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, not only holy, but pleasing. Would God be pleased, let me ask you this, where you take your body? Maybe in a relationship, and God would not be pleased with how that relationship is going and where you're taking your bodies. Maybe God's not pleased where you're taking your bodies with what you do on the weekend. Maybe God's not pleased with what you're doing with your body when no one else is awake, your parents are asleep, with what you're doing in your room at night. But ask yourself, would God be pleased when you walk through the halls of school and your speech and how you talk, would God be pleased? Would God say, yeah, they're offering their bodies as a living sacrifice to me, not only holy, but I'm pleased by how they're talking? Ask yourself, evaluate yourself in view of all God's mercies for you, that he didn't give you what you deserve, that he had grace for you, he had love for you. Oh, how he loves you. Are you offering your body as a living sacrifice to him? Something that's holy, something that's pleasing to him. Are you? Because this is your, it says spiritual act of worship, but that word right there literally means reasonable / logic. It's where we get the word logic. Right there where it says spiritual. Some of you might have reasonable in there. It literally means where we get the word logic. Let me ask you guys this. Isn't it logical that we would give ourselves to someone who gave their lives for us? Is that kind of reasonable or logical? Like, that's not like out there? How many would say that's pretty logical? Alright, something that's cool. Let me ask you this. Alright? Let's say I went into one of you guys' rooms and I clean your whole entire room. Alright? Some of you are like, my room ain't dirty. Yeah, it is. But if I went your room and I cleaned your whole entire room and I was like, hey, now can you do this for me? Can you go buy me a Snickers? How many would be like, that's pretty logical. That's pretty reasonable. How many would say that? Some of you are like, you come to my house anytime, I'll buy you Snickers. All right. If I went over to your house, how many of you drive? You get a live sticker. You can stick it on the back of your car here in a little bit. Represent. All right. If I went over to your house, all right, and I washed your whole entire car inside and out, put a little air freshener in there too, get all the McDonald's fries out of the seat, would it be logical, would it be reasonable for you to give me a ride? That'd be even trade? Yeah? Well, let me ask you guys again. Is it reasonable, is it logical that if someone has mercy not just one time on you, but every single day of their life, isn't it reasonable for us to offer our bodies to them as a living sacrifice to them, holy and pleasing? Is that logical? Is it reasonable? Hopefully that's logical to you. That makes sense to you. that I really believe when we understand God's mercies for us, our natural response would be to worship Jesus with everything. Our best response to the mercies of God tonight is to worship. That's our best response. Because we're going to be so grateful, we're going to be so overwhelmed with what God has done for us that we can only do one thing and one thing alone and worship Him and praise Him for all He's done in our life. I really believe you guys would worship like never before when you came in here and you thought to yourself, man, God had mercy on me. Like, Jesus took the cross for me. So therefore, I want to do anything and everything for my life to be a living sacrifice and one that is worshipful to Him every single day. One that's worshipful. Are you worshiping Jesus with everything? We say, man, they're worshiping me. Like, I can tell how grateful they are for me. Well, they say that. But I really believe worship is offering your everyday life to God. Some of y'all might view worship tonight, maybe some of y'all who are younger, you might view worship tonight as something that you do on Sunday morning, something that you do on Wednesday nights. No. Worship is something that you do every single day of your lives by being a living sacrifice to Jesus. You are a living sacrifice when you love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. You're a living sacrifice. When you wake up every single day and you're like, man, how can I die to myself? How can I worship Jesus? How can I point people to Jesus? How can I worship Jesus like never before? Because I understand how much mercy He has had for me. See, we weren't designed to operate on a weekly worship cycle, but rather to run on a 24 worship style. Or like you didn't say 7. 24/7 worship. Every single day. You should be worshiping Jesus in everything that you do, whether you're on playing sports, whether you're in the band, no matter what you're doing, you're worshiping Jesus. Is it something that is wholly pleasing and a reasonable act of worship to Jesus? Is it? Because what did Jesus do for you? What did Jesus do for you guys? What did He do for you guys? What does this do for you? Nothing, right? Some of you are like, but it could get me a trophy. You take that trophy to heaven with you? No. What does that do for you? I really believe our response when we understand the mercies of God, our response will be either we ignore it or we will repent and worship God because of it. So we all need to understand tonight that God has had extreme mercy on you. Because some of you might see God as someone who's ready to strike you by lightning. Like, if He was going to strike you by lightning, He would already strike you by lightning. All right? But God loves you too much. He cares about you too much that He wants you to change. That He's been trying to get your attention tonight through whatever. Could have been through someone. And He wants you to repent and turn from it. And some of you, you just keep ignoring it. And God's going to continue to have mercy on you. But it might be too late one day. Might be too late one day. Understand, Jesus took the cross for you. Took the nails for you. Some of y'all think of nails and y'all think of a small nail. Some of y'all can never begin to experience the pain of what Jesus went through for you when His feet and His hands were nailed to the cross. Some of y'all might look at cross as something that you wear, something that's decoration. But it was meant to be something for life transformation. It was meant to show you guys that he has extreme mercy on you, has extreme love for you, has extreme grace for you, that he will go through no matter what pain he has to go through. No matter if it's a crown of thorns, no matter if it's getting spit on, no matter if it's getting mocked, but he will go to whatever length he possibly can go to for you. And I really believe once we understand all that he's done for us, we view everything in life through his mercies, we will offer our bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. And we will worship him like never before. Worship him like never before. Have you seen God for his mercies for you? Tonight, I pray that you would worship him because of it, of all his mercies for you, and you give your total commitment to him. Not just half of your total commitment to him, but maybe tonight you've never given your life to Jesus. You've never understood how much mercies he's had for you. Tonight, may I encourage you to turn to repent and to turn to him and thank him for his forgiveness, his grace on you. Let's pray. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Maybe you're here tonight. You say, I've never fully surrendered my life to Jesus before. I never realized like how much mercy, how much grace he had on someone like me. I never realized how much punishment. Like that he carried all my sins, that he offers me forgiveness. Maybe you're here tonight and you do not have a relationship with Jesus. Tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity to come to a relationship with Jesus. So tonight, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus, I want you to repeat a prayer just like this. God, tonight, I surrender. I give you my life. I repent of my sins. I ask for your forgiveness. I confess you as my Lord and my Savior. I believe that you have died on the cross for my sins and have risen from the grave on the third day. Thank you for having mercy on me. Thank you for loving me. I invite you to come into my life tonight, to change me from the inside out. Heads are bowed and eyes are still closed. Maybe you're here tonight and you have a relationship with Jesus. May I encourage you, may I challenge you to give your total commitment to Jesus. And how you worship, don't hold anything back. Offer your whole entire bodies to Jesus. Don't hold anything back when you worship Jesus. He never held anything back from you. God gives us his very best. God, tonight I pray for the decisions that were made. God, I pray that we would be people who worship you. We would do anything and everything for you because of God, what you've done for us and the light of your mercies for us. God, we love you. And all these things I pray, amen. Maybe you're here tonight and you're that person, you say, I do not have a relationship with Jesus. I don't have a relationship with Jesus. In just a second, if that's you, you say, no, I don't have a relationship with Jesus and I want a relationship with Jesus. In just a second, I'm going to count to three. And when I count to three, I want you to stand. Somebody like, why in the world would you do that? I don't do it to embarrass you. I don't do it to humiliate you. I do it to celebrate with you. There's a room full of people in this room, a lot of people who know Jesus. Jesus has changed their life. You know what they're going to do? They're going to celebrate with you. They're going to clap with you. There's nothing to be embarrassed about. I tell people all the time, Jesus died in public on a cross. He went through it all in front of everybody. He didn't do it privately. He didn't do it in a closet. If you're going to give your life to Christ tonight, right here, we're going to encourage you. We're going to champion alongside of you to live for him outside of you. So maybe you're here tonight, you've given your life to Christ for the very first time. I'm going to count to three. I'm just going to invite you to stand. We're going to clap. We're just going to get your name. We're going to get you to put down your date. That's it. Somebody like, can I ask any creepy questions?
No.
That's you tonight. You say, you know what? Give my life to Christ. I'm in a relationship with Jesus. I don't know where I would be if I died tonight. I don't know if I'd spend eternity with Jesus. That's you. God speaking to you.
is invite you. When I count to three, you stand. That's you. 1, 2, 3. Anybody tonight? Second chances, God's a God of 1,000 chances. But why wait? You know, God's speaking to you, he's telling you, man, you have a relationship with him. I'm gonna count to three just one more time. Give me another opportunity. There's gonna be several opportunities tonight, whether it's through a live group, whether it's coming in the gray room and sharing with somebody. But maybe you're here tonight, you say, you know what? I need to stand, I have no courage, and now maybe you don't have no courage, you need someone to stand with you. Encourage them to stand with you. Go walk with you. That's you tonight. I'm just gonna count through one more time. 1, 2, 3. Anybody tonight? Anybody else? Don't leave anybody out. That's you. Anybody else? I want to let you both know, I'm stinking proud of you. Know right now, this room got a little bit crazy. But what's going on right now, like the Super Bowl will soon be here, all right? And we'll have parties for Super Bowls. Think about the Super Bowl times like a million or a billion. That's what's going on in heaven right now. That they're rejoicing, they're going crazy. I'm going crazy on the inside. I'm proud of you guys. What I'd love for you guys to do, like I said, we're just going to get your name. We're going to rejoice with you in the date. And once you never forget it, you don't have a Bible, we're going to give you a Bible. Alright? Might even get a picture with you later on. Alright? If you let me do that. Can you let me do that? Yeah. So I'd love for you guys, if you guys could just make your way to the gray room, they're gonna give you a hand. If you guys will all stand with me tonight, y'all stand. I'm gonna be in the back by the gray room. If you need someone to pray with, I'm always back when there's leaders all in the room. If you need someone to pray with, leaders in the room, I'm in the back. I encourage you, listen to this song. May my whole life be a blazing offering to you, God. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory, Lord. May that be your anthem. May that be your song every single day that you wake up. God, take my life. Let it be all for you and for your glory. Not for glory for myself, not for glory for another, but God, glory for you. Would you sing tonight?
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to me, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them.
in the last 10, 15 minutes of a live is we break up into live groups. You guys get connected with someone in your grade. You get connected with an adult who loves you, who cares about you. So I'm going to dismiss by grade and gender.